everybody to the Martin E. Siegel microphone. Maybe you might not even need it, but it's going to be recorded.
So again, welcome everybody to the Martin E. Siegel Theater Center here at the Graduate Center CUNY for our event celebrating the life and work of the great Herbert Blau. And it means a lot to us that you took out time of your life to come here and be with us. The music you just heard was some of his favorite music while he played, and the evening will be video in the beginning from Dick Blau, his son, who is with us here, who put it together, a short attempt to grasp this life he lived. Then we will sit down, and Joe Roach and Bonnie Moranka will give some remarks, and we will have a discussion, and Chris Fisher will talk about the documentary she's working on, and hopefully all you can join in. I would like to welcome Professor Marvin Carlson, who is here with us tonight, great support of our center, but also a good friend and colleague of Herb Blau, but also Robin Wagner, the great American stage designer, who, as we learned this afternoon, was 19 years old when he did his first work in the theater for Herb Blau in San Francisco. So thank you for coming. My name is Frank Henschke. I'm the executive director and director of programs. And what we try to do here actually sounds like a Herb Blau idea, at least we hope. We bridge academia and professional theater, international and American theater. And we really looked up to him, even so, unfortunately, I never met him. We invited him, but he wasn't sure if he could travel. But he really was, as I said in the afternoon, a star on the heaven of theater for many who oriented their boats on the ocean, you know, of their lives in the theater, where to go and what to do. And I think he was also ready to give advice and gave good ones and help, and was an academic director, but also by an arts institution, and all of it on a very, very high level. And this is so rare, and I think this is really and truly missed. And tonight we will just, you know, try to honor him and his work. And since he lived in San Francisco, his name is not as much out here in New York as it should be, but our evening surely is an attempt to honor it. So maybe we would like to ask you for a short moment of silence in the memory of him, and then we're going to ask Dick to go up, speak a bit before we show your video. One second, let me see if your mic is on. Let's just make sure it's turned on. Sean. Maybe use mine for the moment. I'll just attach it here because we are recording.
Sure.
Sorry about that.
I first met Herb Blau when I was 6 years old, and he was 22. I was, by all accounts, including my own, a little monster and headed for a very bad place. Thinking back and remembering what I was like at 22, I can now appreciate just what an achievement it was to gentle me. Herb took me up with a kind of warmth that I will never forget, a deeply sustained affection that allowed me to believe in myself in some fundamental way. It wasn't perfect what he did, but he brought to the task a combination of patience, warmth, and discipline that I sorely needed, and he won me over in the end. He also provided a model, a set of ideals about the proper life. Herb believed, above all, in the importance of work, in the necessity of self-creation that could only be accomplished through the ceaseless exercise of one's faculties. I remember building his first desk with my mom, the desk upon which he wrote his massive dissertation out of orange crates that we painted gray. I remember him working in his Alpine Terrace study under the stairs in the basement with a window on the garden, sitting over that portable royal and rubbing his hands together in what seemed to me at the time to be a kind of prestidigitation. I remember the particular assured sound with which his fingers hit the keys, his straight back, the force field of his concentration. Then there was the workshop. How lucky can a kid get? Herb and Bee and Priscilla, and Buddy and Alan and Bob and Patty and all the others, Robin, Marion Haley, actors, technicians, artists of the future like Mort Subotnick, conjured up a world for me every 6 weeks or so for the run of 15 years. A fantastic trip it surely was, so full of invention, undertaken with such urgency and earnestness, always asking serious questions about important things, even when the subject was funny. In the theater, as in everything, Herb taught by example. To look as hard at the world and as deep into the self as you could, and then to say something real about it. It was an uplifting and also a daunting experience watching Herb at work. And when it came to figure out what our own work would be, it took us kids a while to find a space where there was enough oxygen. Through it all, he never wavered in his support. He was always there to take us up, to take us in, to help us out through thick and thin, and sometimes things were very, very thin. He never bullshitted us either. For him, honesty was the only policy, along with the encouragement you always knew where he stood because he told you so. I eventually realized that it didn't actually matter to him what path we took, how different it was from his. What he really wanted was for us to explore our capacities to the fullest in whatever ways we could. One result of this is that there are now a lot of doctors in the family. I used to kid him that he believed in mind over matter and that most of his children had chosen to believe in matter over mind. For my part, if I started out to be a literary critic like him, I eventually chose image over word quite guiltily, I should say, until I saw that for him it was really about intensity, not form, even though he never stopped encouraging me to write. God embraces the hot and the cold, but spews out the lukewarm from his mouth. That quote from Dostoevsky was one of his favorites, one of the ones he truly loved. Security is the suburbs of hell, only a dead wall between. This from John Webster was another. Taught us courage, too. Although you didn't see it often, he really had come from the streets of Brownsville, New York. I remember we were living in Palo Alto and he sent me back out to fight some kids who had been tormenting me. It didn't matter if I lost, you just didn't back down from a fight. In later years, and on much larger issues, at Lincoln Center, at CalArts, and finally when we were colleagues at UWM, I saw this instinct at work in other ways as well. This was someone who risked his security at every turn, intellectually and institutionally. There was nothing that was not open to question. It was a matter of the deepest principle. His visceral contestation with the culture, academic, artistic, and otherwise, was inspiring to behold. What made it especially moving was that he was not by any means simply a contrarian. This was a person who was fully engaged in trying to make a better world, and on many fronts, while at the same time he was fully aware of and deeply alarmed by the way he saw things going. Throughout it all, given the far-reaching immensity of his effort, what was truly remarkable was how committed he also was to being a good dad. You can see it in the pictures, in the palpable delight he found in his children. In the one case where that love was not enough, and our sister Tara's estrangement from him, there was no question but that this was one of the most painfully felt failures in an otherwise enormously successful life. I could say more. Everyone here could say more, were there but world enough and time. Let me close by saying that I often think of my dad as a kind of figure out of Blake. In Blake's Milton, there is a self-created poet, Los, the traveler through eternity, who carries the heavens with him like a tent, who is mourned by everyone he leaves and welcomed by everyone he meets. Well, maybe not everyone, but you all know what I mean. Okay. What an extraordinary man my father was. It's a true privilege to call myself his son. Thank you.
this one I remember, Aunt Elizabeth. Yeah. And this is my what became my crazy Aunt Rosie, whom I wrote about. Rosie, whom I wrote about in my autobiography. And this is my mother. Yet of Blau. This is my mother and father when they were married. My mother was the laziest woman who ever existed. But everybody adored her. This is my father, Joseph Blau. Yeah, he was born in the United States on Allen Street on Broadway. That's my brother, Sidney. And sister-in-law. The two of them were champion dancers in high school. Yeah. And this is Baba. That's my grandmother, whom I adored. I write in the autobiography, she'd be a saint if Jews had saints. This is my report card.
Conduct B plus.
Oh. No, yeah. Well, sometimes I got D's. I used to be proud when I got D's.
Are you saying in front of a black kid?
Yeah, there's one black kid in the class. There's one black kid.
What about her? Another one.
This is the Pan American medal that I got.
For what?
I was very good in Spanish, and I got the Pan American medal. Henry Wallace, remember Henry Wallace, the he sent me a letter. I have the letters. And this is when I was in the infantry before I went into the paratroops. This is when I jumped out of the, when I was in the, this is what they call the B stage, which was more frightening than jumping out of airplanes. This is like the equivalent of Phi Beta Kappa.
It's the honor society.
Yeah, that's right, yeah. I began to write for the University Heights Daily News. In fact, I have all the stuff in my closet there. I have all those issues that I got from their archives. And then I became eventually the editor of the Heights Daily News. It's when I met your mother and... Yeah, I went to Greenwich Village. She lived in Greenwich Village. This is when she moved out with Bick to when I lived on Los Altos. We lived just below Palo Alto in a little cabin. But what was nice was the outside. There's a walnut tree, and we were sitting. They took this picture. We were. These are the our kids and the Irving kids. And this is Dick. And this is, wait a second, this is Tara, this is Katie Irving, David Irving, and this is Amy Irving, this is you. But when the workshop started on Divisadero Street in this loft, which was about the size from this wall to the window, the second play we did was Hedda Gabler, and this is the cast, and B played Hedda Gabler. This is Dick Lyer. Bob Ross and John Clark.
Wait, who? Who's the first
this
one?
This is Bob John Ross. Clark. Yeah, John Clark and Richard Blyer. And this is B and Tom Roski in the second play I directed, which is Tennessee Williams' Summer and Smoke. Yeah.
Summer.
And this is what we moved scenery around in.
Love it.
And this is the theater up here. It used to be a Ford... warehouse, and then it was a church also. And up here in the ramp, we used to have art exhibits. This is Alan Mandel and Jules. He was the one I telling you about. Alan.
He's real skinny.
Well, he's not. He was the one I called yesterday. But Alan was a poor young actor from Toronto. Came to the workshop. And lived literally in our shop in a room half the size of this. And then he married Wells Fargo.
Where
is he now? Oh, he lives in Westwood. He has a... This was the third play I directed, which was Oedipus, Sophocles Oedipus. Yeah. And that's Joseph Miksak, M-I-K-S-A-K. Joe Miksak. He was a... colleague of mine at San Francisco State, but he was an actor.
So how did you choose the plays?
At the beginning, we chose these plays, for the people, but I got more interested in doing classic plays. But then as time went on, we began to choose the plays that the workshop became famous for, the things that scandalized everybody that nobody wanted to, Genet, Beckett, Pinter. We did the first Pinter play in America. Yeah, and this is Waiting for Godot. This is Bob Simons and Gene Roach.
But that's not the one that was done on the Encore.
No, we did a different one at the Anka. Yeah. We did a different version. This was this was the one that went to the Brussels World's Fair and then to the Seattle World's Fair. It was the first time I ever came to Seattle. Was when
I didn't get the part because I was too tall.
This is the first production of Brecht's Mother Courage in America.
Wow.
Yeah, this was the play Mother Courage.
And so...
Wait, which one?
So this was in New York?
No.
This is San Francisco now.
Okay. Yeah. And yeah, this is from Mother Courage too. Yeah, this is when the opening of Mother Courage when they come in. Captains and you can roll straight on.
That mentions that ding dong.
I explained why.
I gotta find that guy.
He played King Lear when he was 27 years old.
That's a rotten shame that
it's amazing.
He's such a great
closing. That's the closing. He needs to dress us that way.
In your face?
That's not my face. I got something in my mouth. I'm chewing.
This is Endgame. Yeah, and Bob Levine, whom I told you, is just...
But that's, who's that there, right there?
That's Tom Roski, and underneath these hands are Bob Simons. This was gorgeous, and the set was beyond belief.
Isn't that right, a big, long paper on Endgame?
Yeah, this is Rex Galileo. This is fantastic. About 15 artists who worked on it. And every object was an art object, like this chess set here. You know, it was done by an artist. So. And the big problem we had is that it was very hard to keep our properties in our shop in the Folsom Street District.
This is people
the woman who originally played the horse girl in the Genet's The Balcony. You know, and this was before nudity. Way before nudity, you could have nude people on stage, everybody's seeing that. People were utterly scandalized by this in those days. But.
What?
Herb had a big smile.
Each smaller group.
So, again, thank you all for coming, and also thank you for being with us. So Joe Roach, who you all know, of course, and also from the bio here. You have a message from us.
I do. Thank you, Frank, and thank you, Sarah, and everyone who has helped arrange this program. Herb meant a lot to me. I know he meant a lot to all of you. And it's an honor to be able to remember him in your company. And I'm bearing a message from Ellen Diamond, who couldn't be here, very much wanted to, but sent a reminiscence to me to read to you. And in getting this, I thought of a line from Herb that sticks with me. Many do, but this one just came to my mind when I got Ellen's message. It comes from Nothing in Itself, Complexions of Fashion, when Herb writes, "I am not a fashionable man, but I have always liked stylish women." And I'm that just set a train of associations in motion of women that made an impression on Herb, and also women that Herb made an impression on. And I think, first of all, of the two Peggies, Peggy Lee, who is wonderfully remembered in As If, when Herb got to dance with her in Tompkins Square Park at a concert afterwards, or during the piece, he got a chance to dance with Peggy Lee. And it's beautifully evoked in his memoir. And then the other one is Peggy Phelan. I had the privilege of being with Peggy the first time she heard Herb read from his work. And there was a silence, and Peggy looked at me and she said, "Whatever it is he's smoking, I want some." And it really reminds me that along with Herb and stylish women, there's Herb and style. And Ellen evokes that that connection, and I want to read her remarks. I may depart for them at a couple of places just to gloss a few things. "I'm sorry to be out of town today. I thank Frank Henschner and Sarah Stites for organizing this important event. I thank Joe for being kind enough to read my remarks. What I have to say is based on my contribution to a memorial forum for Herb to be published in the winter issue of TDR, and it has to do with unfinished business. Last year, before completing the introduction for Herb's Programming Theater History, the Actors' Workshop of San Francisco, we just saw the cover shot there a minute ago, I paid a visit to the Actors' Workshop archive at the Billy Rose Theater Collection. I went through a box or two of programs and photos and began to feel upset that the archive was at Lincoln Center. I wanted it to be at San Francisco State. Not that that beleaguered institution would want the archive or could manage it, but that's where Herb and Jules Irving were teaching when they started the Actors' Workshop. That's where Herb shared an office with Ruby Cohn, commencing a 50-year-plus friendship, and I might add there a 50-year-plus collaboration on Beckett and Beckett criticism. And in thinking about this, I was reminded of the acknowledgments for sales to the Herring Fleet, where Herb, in acknowledging Ruby's influence and importance in his own work on Beckett, remembered an MLA panel that had Ruby chaired, Herb, of course, and Beatrice Manley, the wonderful actress and former wife of Herb, and then Dick Blau. All of them were talking about Beckett. Dick had been directing Beckett at Harvard. And they just don't make panels like that at MLA anymore, at least in recent memory. I wanted to tap that. That's where, that is at San Francisco State, Ellen continues, the day after the birth of the workshop on January 16, 1952, in a loft on Divisadero Street, Herb was probably running to teach a class out from that foggy campus not far from the beach to support his growing family. 13 years after nurturing the great experiment that was the Actors' Workshop, Blau and Irving left San Francisco to take the reins of the repertory company at Lincoln Center. Near where I was sitting at the Billy Rose Theater Collection, Herb's first two New York productions, that's near where I was sitting at the Billy Rose Theater Collection as she's working on this archive, Herb's first two New York productions failed to please, pushing him to resign. The material archive of the actor's workshop, uprooted from where it began, resides at the place where it fell apart. Well, so what? A child of the Bay Area, I'm always a bit nostalgic about San Francisco, but Herb wasn't. He called it a king-size Greenwich Village. And at that point, I just want to break away for a minute from Ellen to reflect on the importance in my career as a college student in 1965, reading The Impossible Theater right after it came out, and putting that together with Harold Clurman's The Fervent Years, and thinking about the possibilities that The Impossible Theater opened up. It was a remarkable book. It remains a remarkable book. And I'm just remembering the first line. It's the purpose of this book, to talk up a revolution. It was a revolution in theater and beyond. Ellen continues, at first the archive yielded little beyond lovely black and white photos of workshop rehearsals and productions, along with letters, programs, memos, and memorabilia. Then I saw something quite unusual and unsettling. I wanted to put it in the introduction, but I couldn't figure out how. Although Herb and Kathy liked what I wrote, it feels unfinished to me because of that omission. I think that's what she means by unfinished business. What I'm talking about are four or five photographs, more or less identical, of a rehearsal of Samuel Beckett's Endgame in the Subterranean Encore Theater in probably March or April of 1959. Endgame opened May 10th. Unlike virtually every other rehearsal photo in the archive, the camera is not on the actor, the scene, the set, the program, but on Herb. Herb is directing Robert Simons, an actor he greatly admired, playing Ham, and the camera behind Ham catches the back of Simons' head and is pointed at Herb. That is, the camera shows the point of view of Ham, as if Ham were looking at Herb, and Herb looks, well, this is why I couldn't use those photos, and why an offhand reference seemed trivializing. Herb knew those pictures were being taken. He permitted it to happen. He staged it. If theater is, as he says in Take Up the Bodies, theory or the shadow of it, these photos shadow Herb's own desire to show himself theorizing. I found it embarrassing. I looked away, embarrassed for him. He wanted his watching watched, a primordial theater experience. He always told us, courtesy of the theater's attachment to surveillance. Theater space, Herb writes, quote, resembles consciousness itself, unquote, and consciousness is, quote, a play of mind and a mind at play, unquote, which in the case of Endgame drives its four half-humans to the limit of our ability to think about them. Directing it, bringing it to life, Herb wanted to remember himself there, and that desire is in his face as he sits behind his director's table, unsmiling, looking lost. Lost in thought? Was he posing? Was he enacting the illusion of seeing which for him theater always solicits? Was he hoping to freeze in time his own skepticism, his own compulsion to see past the vanishing point? Another of his favorite tropes. I have to say that my efforts to narrativize those photos still seem nonsensical, not to mention flagrantly Oedipal. But embarrassment is gone, replaced by pleasure and a bit of excitement. In As If, his memoir of 2011, Herb writes, quote, with Endgame, I started asking that series of questions. Act how? Act why? Act where? And what do we mean by acting? End quote. I think the photos show us where those questions come from. Herb knew that directing Endgame was formative, that living in Endgame, and therefore in his own mind as he watched them, both mind and play, materialize, would change everything. So he took a picture. He had one taken, more than one. I hope I haven't domesticated them out of strangeness, because these photos are deeply strange and deeply intimate. They belie narrative and encourage too much of it. An impossible knot worthy of Herb. Herb's books are far from easy. He wrote sentences that capture the movement of his consciousness, not ours. Hence the parataxes, the appositives, asides, and looping digressions that can be utterly confounding. But then comes a dazzling aphorism that somehow transcends the confusion. Quote, death cannot be represented. Death can only be represented, end quote. Quote, in theater as in love, the subject is disappearance, end quote. Quote, there is the inconsolable body in its divisions, refusing ultimately to be consoled, end quote. Quote, look at the plays, see what they show, end quote. Fiercely frustrated by Take Up the Bodies in the mid-1980s, I read it now and the other books with relative ease, and I'm not the only one. Herb has taught us, and he was a great teacher, how to read him, or rather reading him has something to do with how we read the world. He became a durable particle in the lenses we wear. I'm not sure how this happened, but it makes me feel that what's unfinished need not be accounted for. It turns my weary sadness at Herb's passing into something like joy. Thanks for listening, and thanks to Joe for reading.
Thank you. And yeah, she really wanted to be here, but it was just not possible. And we heard her words through you, so thank you. Bonnie Moranka from PAJ Performing Arts Journal, who has also published him articles, but also books. You prepared some remarks, and please let us know. Thank you.
I was deciding what I would do today, and I looked up, I did some research on all the articles that Herb had published in PAJ, and of course we published his book, Blooded Thought, and there are 10 or 12 articles at least over the years. So I decided that I would kind of put together a sort of collage that would offer a sort of portrait of Herb in 7 paragraphs that I chose from many of the different texts. And I'm just going to read them now to give a picture of his thought. The first one is, the best of modern poetry has taught us that words are about things that wouldn't exist without words. I believe the same might be said of the language of theater, a concept which wouldn't exist without the meaning of words. Another one, moral blindness, spiritual blindness, these are traditional concerns of art, particularly tragic drama, where the crisis, if irreparable, is so painfully explored as to bring wisdom from suffering, or so, in their woeful lamentations, the ancient choruses say. But that implied a cultural unity that, even if we wanted it in this age of border crossings, romanticized in the academy, but abysmal for many who cross, is only to be remembered. And even then, as something questionable or unattainable. Or as Euripides saw the civilizing claims of the Athenian Empire when it was about to go under, a worn-out fiction, delusional too. It may be that ground zero is where our sense of the tragic revives. At the center of any critical theory today, not only in the theater, is the problematic of the audience. Who's there? Quote unquote. The issue is raised in the opening words of Hamlet, the play whose symptoms are almost a definition of modernity, with its swarm of percussive questions in the play within the play. Not only who, but where and why, and in what space of thought, in the superstructure or the cellarage. When we think of an audience today, we are not only concerned with the number in attendance, but the attentiveness to an absence. The presence of otherness in the process of watching, the watching and being watched, estrangement and distance, and the degree to which division, the unstable substance of theater mirrored in the event, has since become its subject. The problem at that limit is a solipsistic anxiety that nobody may be looking, which has become, through an inversion of the voyeuristic fear we see in Kafka, a paranoid constituent of the performing self. Another one, the older I get, what compels me to art is what brought me there in the first place, when other options, in parentheses, I was to begin with a chemical engineer, in parentheses, seemed a lot safer with reliable benefits. Art is still what you do because you must or because you can't do without it. Since I'd been doing without it for some time, not making theater, I've come to think of myself as a theorist, though with reflexes there still determined by the art of performance, what I've meant by quote-unquote blooded thought. Whatever the impulsions of a politics or the required activism of any historical moment, I have never quite bought the critique of formalism or of modernism and still believe that new forms are themselves the prospects of new social content, models, method, and that a certain historical obscurity in art may be an unexpected source of energy, liberating in ways that political attitudes are not. Art is what happens when I think better of myself. To the degree that there's any purity in that, it accounts for the discrepancy between what I am and what I'd like to be. I can, at some level, even when I fail in art, respect myself there more than I can in reality, which is to say, I'm known to myself more acutely in art than I am known to myself outside it. This is not all egocentric. Art for me has always been the means by which I become more available to myself and thus more responsible. What is really troubling is that there is no new natural discourse among practitioners in this presumably social art, no ideational framework for it, and mostly no desire. As for the inspiriting years of experiment, it suffered as it happened, and to this day, from an inadequate criticism, an untheorized practice, and through incurable intellectualism, lapses of memory. What I'm speaking of now is the incessant amnesia of the American experience, in which, unable to assess and sustain ideas, the best of them seem to get lost, and we start all over again. This final piece is published in the current issue, PAJ 105. It's the opening pages of the first chapter, Unfinished, which is the second volume of his memoir. So it's his last piece of writing, and we publish it, and it appears in the current issue, as I said. This is the opening paragraph. Some months ago, in the last meeting of a seminar with the oxymoronic title Traditions of the Avant-Garde, I announced that after nearly 64 years of teaching, I had decided to retire. And as I sit here now confronting the rest of this life and what I might write about it, how long, how much, the dire prospect that keeps us guessing, my wife reminds me that we must see a lawyer to revise our wills. My will, of course, was nothing like the aged king's when more than half a century ago I was staging Shakespeare's play, nor was there anything then or now like that kingdom to divide, unless it be life itself. But as we return to where we left him with the quote-unquote dark energies there, it's as if by some conjunctive link to that sovereign power, we share the, quote, fast intent to shake all cares and business from our age, end quote. And then, of course, there's that other periodic meaning of age, that ancient time, this imperiled now, in which the faults abound, quote, world, world, oh world, end quote, with some trans-historical inexpugnable madness.
Okay, that's it. Thank you. Thank you so much, Bonnie, and for sharing and putting it together, but also for publishing it. And Chris, before we come to you, I just want to ask Joe Beck, because you read so much now of Alan's work. What did Herb Blau mean to you?
Well, the first thing I want to say is he was a model in many ways, but the way that is perhaps the most profound, his thought, his writing at the highest levels of criticism and theory was always supported by, as Bonnie quoted the line, blooded thought. He made work. He made work for much of his career. We've heard about the Actors Theater, and of course, we haven't mentioned Kraken, but it would come up in any discussion of his career, and always in touch, always engaged with performance and an art maker himself. And that model was abroad and alive within the Academy for a certain time, and there are still filaments of it that remain. But I see the field of theater following the path of history of art and art, dividing into specialists in writing and researching and thinking, and then specialists in doing and making work. And that separation is something that Herb just resisted, even when he wasn't making work later on in Milwaukee or in Seattle. He was still working through the work that he had made endlessly and powerfully and deeply and passionately. It was the impetus that made him the thinker that he was. And what that means to me, to answer your question, is the untapped potential of the performing arts, especially theater, in the academy, in American culture writ large.
Thank you. Chris, we showed this afternoon some excerpts of your film. You did an interview with him how many years ago?
Actually, it was just about a year ago.
Just a year ago. You have 16 or 17 hours of material. We showed about 2 hours. Tell us about that experience. Why did you do it, and how did that feel?
Well, I had known her then about 11 or 12 years and had been so entranced by his stories and his... and I didn't think any of it was on tape, any of it was filmed. I certainly had read his work since I was a young pup in theater in college, but to hear him then read it and discuss it and describe and do some of the exercises, do some of the lines that he'd done in his seminal productions, that brought it to a different level of reality. And I thought it essential for the students, for the theater artists of today to hear that. I got my MFA from Rutgers, and I don't think anyone ever breathed a word about Herbert Blau during that, and I know that's true in so many graduate programs. And I felt this might be one way to connect the students and performers of today to this astonishing wealth of work.
What were moments, we showed some of them, but what were moments you felt, this is his, you know, that's Herb Blau himself? Can you maybe tell us, since we can't show them all, what were some of the scenes or you felt really represented his life and work?
Well, there's obviously, as you know, so many. Herb is usually known by the density of his thought, the extraordinary intellectualism. But watching him in these films or being with him in person, he was the visceral energy force of what mattered. I mean, they were ideas, yes, but it was a life and death experience. And you see that over and over again when he discusses this work and the possibilities of theater, which he despaired of and also embraced. I also heard that from talking to his graduate school students. I mean, he taught in the English program at both Milwaukee and in Seattle. And each of his students that I interviewed who had seen him chair their dissertations, they said he gave them a model of how to be in the profession, and that it wasn't just thinking, but that reading and thinking was a life and death issue. And he brought that to the stage. And you can see that in the interviews he gives. It is utterly vibrant, and it utterly disappears when he is not in front of you.
Yeah. I thought there were some, you know, very intense moments there where even through the video screen it transformed. So, Bonnie, you have done 105 PAJs, and there's many contributors, from the art side, from the gallery world, but also from the theater world. Practice artist. Where does he fit in that whole chorus of voices? What made him special?
Well, Herb actually loved visual arts, and he was very conversant in it. Some of the painters he had brought to Cal Arts, and he also kept up with his friends in painting and also music. Morton Subotnick was mentioned. Poetry. He was a great reader of poetry. Herb was a model of an intellectual. I feel that he was perhaps the only person who was maybe a philosopher of theater in the country. And having just been dealing with the death of Stanley Kaufman, another very close friend of mine who died last week at 97. I have to say, thinking about both men together, they were great, you know, intellects, but also great sensual people. And they, until their dying day, they were reading and talking and engaging with the world. And to me, they're just models of exemplary lives. And I look at them that way. Herb was a great friend since I met him in the 70s. We have lots of letters that we corresponded. We also talked by phone several times a year. I saw him in Paris and New York, though never in Seattle. And I think that his work, if you look at the pages of work, he was writing about rap music, or he was writing about painting, writing about new dance, writing about theater. I think he took it as a model, a kind of intellectual non-specialization in a way. He never taught in the theater department, but simply that everything in life was of interest and could be made incredibly exciting and thought-provoking just by bringing your intelligence to bear on it. I think, unfortunately, we are losing that sense today by the over-specialization in the university, and just the kind of focus on one's work today and now, right in front of them, and in front of people, everyone is for different reasons is narrowed into a kind of small blocks of time, small research areas, often not very interdisciplinary. He just was of a different time, and I think that also we forget. Because we've come so far in a half a century, people like Dan here who died 2 years ago, or people like Stanley, or some of the translators, people like Herb, we forget that that generation in their 80s really created the field for us in modern drama and theater and contemporary theater. There was so much even in the 60s and 70s that was never made available in translation or never thought about, or, you know, just the whole sense of what they brought in the post-war period, I think, is a really strong legacy. And I'm not so certain that people are aware of it because of our focus on the present. But for me, Herb was just a great man and a great man of the theater, even though he spoke about his own anti-theatrical prejudice. I think many of the great thinkers in theater in the 20th century hated the theater in a very ironic way and in a very dynamic way of critiquing it. It's the only way one can exist in the theater, by hating it.
Yeah, that is an interesting thought, and I think Brecht was that, if you can't think in contradiction, you're petit bourgeoisie, you're a little liberal, you have to be able to live in those
or
dialectic
Hanukkah
terms.
Also, the Germans were, German language drama was famous for that.
Yeah. Dick, Herb was a father figure in a way for so many artists, you know, the Lee Breuer. Actually, we had Ruth Maleczech was supposed to be here tonight. And of course, we lost her too, and or Julie Tame or Bill Irving and so many, many others before. Robin, you know, who was at the age of 19, did his first stage that was him and so many others. You also ended up in the university. Was that part of his idea, his mission to teach, to preach? Almost like a, he looks on the videos almost like a priest or like a holy man, you know, who gives out.
I think he was fundamentally a teacher. He was very, very important. How many PhD students he had at Seattle. It was enormous. More than anybody.
He had 11. No,
11.
The last year of his teacher.
He did see himself as a someone deeply committed to the most advanced and serious kind of pedagogy. And I actually took that Traditions of the Avant-Garde course, audited it when at UWM, and it was a thick experience in every sense of the word. It was just it was as dense and as serious and extensive as could possibly be. The students were always there past the end of class, And you could see that he was actually gaining energy, right, as these sessions went on, and gaining energy from his interactions with the students. So I think it was very, very important to something essential in his being. Mm-hmm.
He was a teacher, but also he was a director. Who did you see? I'm sure you all saw his work. Maybe you can comment on plays you saw by him.
I know it only through his evocations of it and others' evocations of it, knowing veterans of his companies, but I never saw anything he staged live. But the interesting thing about that is it is as if I did, because I've lived with his production since the moment of Lincoln Center, when he came to national prominence in this moment of extraordinary opportunity and hope, and then hope is dashed, but it was still inspiring, because wherever you turn in the American theater during Herb's lifetime, there was something that he was involved in, something that he created, something that he initiated that came to the fore. Certainly Beckett as a director and as a critic putting that into play, and so much else that has been evoked here. But it's, again, it's the blooded thought. It's the thinking through this theater that distinguishes him. It's a quality I think we've all spoken of in one way or another, the word intensity, the word passion, the word commitment, one that hasn't been used, but a total devotion and commitment to the quality of the thinking, which comes from the quality of the work, characterizes him, and in that he was unique.
Bonnie, as far as I know, you saw one production, or?
I saw Kraken. I believe Kraken. That it was in the Performing Garage, the
Tell
company,
us.
The Donner Party. I was trying to refresh my memory from seeing the photographs. I just remember it very, just being a very intense experience, what we would call ensemble theater, or a kind of a collective creation or something. It's a terminology then. And it just was a very rigorous, intense experience. That was the only thing I saw of his.
Sean just went out, but maybe Robin or Marvin, did you see productions of Herb Blau? Did you see productions of Herb Blau?
Yeah, I saw Craig.
Do you have a hand mic?
The Performing Garage. I also saw Gatton's Dare. I would say that, there's no question of Herb's originality and influence. I would resist over mythologizing him as a director. I think incredibly wonderful, very impressive, not in my mind as, although in somewhat in the same genre, but not, I think, as rich or deep as Grotowski's Constant Prince or Acropolis or the late Chaykin works, which were coming out of very much the same way of working, or the same mentality of that period. I will refrain from saying much about Gatton's Dare, though I enjoyed it much more than most people did. But I think, going back again to the point that a number of you have made, that for me, in any case, though I certainly admire the little work that I saw of his, what it seemed to me that Herb was head and shoulders above everybody else in that generation in the theater world was as a thinker. He, as that wonderful tribute to Joe read,
points out, he taught us a way of thinking, a way of seeing, and a kind of rigorousness and depth of analysis, and moreover, opened up in a way something that people in theory in those days didn't talk much about, although Beckett talked a lot about it, and that was the relation between theater and mortality. And nobody thought about that better and deeper and more rigorously than Beckett and Blau did. And so for me, I think I totally agree that the production side, the directing side, was tremendously influential and important. But I think for me, it was the mind of Blau that really distinguishes him and makes a unique contribution.
Yeah. Robin, maybe you can have a little bit of light for the audience so we can see them, but maybe Robin, you worked, tell us how that was. Is this mic on green? Yeah, it is, right? Yeah, hold it close, yeah.
Oh, okay. I worked on Godot, of course, and the only way I could really describe how he worked with me was not being very conscious of what was going on in the theater, because I was about 18 and a half when I first met him. Mm-hmm. They were just happy to have someone who was doing design. And I had been working in ballet, and I had been doing other things in other smaller companies in San Francisco. So what Herb did, I asked him for a script for Godot, and I don't even think that they had a script when we started. I know he was getting one. Maybe he had one for himself. But, he gave me all of his novels, all of Becker's novels, including Malloy and Malone Dives. And he said, read these. And perhaps he'll begin to understand what we're going to be doing. And I did. I ended up reading everything that I could get my hands on. And everything that I worked on with her was like that. He would insist that he really dug around in the background of what these people had written and what it meant. And he was very serious for her. So I was kind of afraid of it. And I didn't have any of that comic experience. He was also very supportive, but if he didn't like something, he'd say, let's do something else. You know, it was a simple way of saying, it stinks. But he was very straightforward that way. And I noticed, not many people have talked about this, when he came to Lincoln Center, I was at Arena Stage at the time, he asked me to come up and work on the second play, not Bad Time, but The Condemned Adoptana. He had enormous influence on the casting, and of course he was the director of theater, but also the influence on design of the department. And he did the same thing when we did downstairs versus the theater form. It was called In Three Zones. And there, he insisted that we explore the use of film, which had not been done in New York to my knowledge, although it may have been done before I got here. And that piece went on. I can't remember the name of the director that went on from there, but that's the one that Herb quit on because he just could not deal with the kind of criticism that he was getting. And I remember him talking about that. It was like so unfair. And his work, I always thought, was brilliant because he had such deep understanding of character. Like he would never discuss, for instance, a geographic location. And that was particularly true in Godot. It doesn't matter. It's just read his work. He did the same thing on In Three Zones. And we'd start exploring what it meant to use every possible medium that you could use in the theater, including projection and including film. And we had a set that gradually moved over to La Mama and became a set for a couple of other plays. So it was always an exploration, and I think that that's how I always felt about him, as a kind of explorer. And even when I worked on the the Galileo, which was heavily considered as well, you always felt Herb's influence. And today, I still every project, I always think of Herb's influence on me. I'm looking at theater in a different way, not as an entertainment, but as an exploration into life. And he was a great talker, as you probably all know. He was whatever I learned from him that I still use today, and in everything I've ever done that's been successful, in my opinion, anyway. But he was deeply involved with everyone involved in the production, including, for instance, the electrician. He'd go and he'd talk about light cues, and he'd become just part of that. So I wouldn't underestimate his directing ability. I think he's a wonderful director. And I was always very, very sad when he up and left. You know, and that's the beginning of a different kind of what they're going to do. I guess it's still there. That real insight that he brought to it and brought to New York was unique. And I don't think anyone's come up with that again, or as well.
I'm thinking here that there's Robin in one moment in relation to Herb's work, and then Julie Taymor at another. Thinking in big conceptual terms of design problems, issues that are related to the drama, the occasion that predicates the need for the scenography, rather than layering on the scenery for its own sake.
Not that I thought of it scenery. Mm-hmm. The best part of that is that some of that's come on. Yeah, I don't really basically like scenery. Mm-hmm. And it's true because I've been accused of that too by managers. But there was something else that was so much richer about Herb's vision of a production. And that he was able to somehow cover me with this feelings and express his feelings about the visualization. And to me, that was, you couldn't ask for a better director. Mm-hmm. I worked with a couple of years.
Yeah.
He was the first and the most influential. So I still have very fond memories of him.
But just Marvin wants to comment. Thanks.
Joe's evocation of Julie Taymor suddenly brought to mind that, a conversation I had with her. One of the things that made that Herb's work so important was that the New York theater, as we all know, is so cowardly and unimaginative comparison with theater in many parts of the rest of the world. And Herb was a breath of fresh air because he took this seriously. He tried to think through. Very little thinking goes on in the American theater on any level, but certainly among directors. and I'm sorry, if you don't agree, that's all right. And therefore, it's really striking when somebody like Taymor pops up. What the thing that flashed in my mind then is Joanna Kalaitis, another person who's dared to do something a little unconventional and whose career at the public theater was somewhat the same as Herb's at the at Lincoln Center. And for it seems to be, in certain measure, the same reasons, or very similar reasons. The story is that not long after Joanna Kalaitis crashed and burned at the Public Theater, I met her in Berlin, and we were talking about this, and her career. And I'll never forget that Herb went on at some length about his sadness that he had not been able to get Sam Beckett and Joanne Acolytis really had something to offer. I thought at the time, the fact that you would try to do that and see it as an obligation, and he did worry about it, also showed something else that people continually brought up, and that is the enormous generosity and attempt to outreach and connect, maybe not with everybody, but with everybody that you thought needed it or could help or could contribute. So I think forgive me for trying to get a number all an observation, but that did strike me again.
Thank you. It's over there. No, can you take the mic? So we are recording.
Can you speak like this? Can you hear me?
No, it's we are recording it. Yes.
Yeah, I started with her in 1916, 1964, San Francisco State. I saw most of the productions of the active workshop series.
This is all.
And one of the effects of coming under her influence, as I'm thinking about it now, hearing you speak, in terms of this one of the kindness, what happens is that theater went into you in a certain way. Maybe there's some nostalgia, maybe there's some mythologizing, but there's some sense of a level of participation that I got from very specific things that happened on the stage, which made it very difficult in my future years to deal with most of what I've seen on the stage. For example, the production of Waiting for Godot and the Endgame that I saw in San Francisco were really the high points of my theater going life on some level. I was in Paris when, right after Beckett won the Nobel Prize, and did a revival, Mr. Gervais did a revival of Waiting for the Go. And it was virtually the most boring thing I've ever seen in my life until about 3 hours. And the French approached it, now that Beckett won a Nobel Prize, every line was it was a museum piece.
Recitation. In other words, they drained all the blood and all the life out of the play. And I was so grateful because at some point I realized, hey, what Herb understood was not only the fierce intellectuality of talking about leaves rustling and feathers rustling, what was behind that, but he also understood Buster Keaton and Charlie Chaplin and the whole vaudeville scene, and he brought that to both Endgame and Godot, you know, and you took away a breathlessness, and his Vanya, I've never seen a Vanya as good. Beatrice Manley did something in that production. He had Sonia talking about how homely she is. I discussed this once when Herb was in New York. And just as she's talking about, oh, I'm so homely, Yelena comes floating through the room. You know, almost like a melody on her way to the piano. And it was one of the most gorgeous things I've ever seen, just that, you know, and then she sits at the piano and she wants to play and she asks for permission. Sonia goes to Sir Bryakov and wants to get his permission so she can play. And Yelena, Beatrice, is just getting ready to play and Sonia comes back in and now Sonia's floating and he says, we can't. And her whole body just goes laps over the piano. Now, this is 1969, or maybe even earlier than that. Probably a little earlier than that. And it's still with me, you know? It's still with me. And I've been teaching for 48 years myself, and Herb used to say I couldn't ever equal him in anything, but this was absolutely impossible. He used to say, I've had 35,000 students. And I said, well, I've had 3,500, you know. But, whatever he did, you know, on some level, he just took the ball and he ran with it, and you followed because you wanted to go there. The thing that's in my mind now is Herb introduced me to the No Theater way back then, and in reading Simi's wonderful manifesto, Simi says, some say the No was created
for the security of the world, others say for the entertainment of the people. And I felt that Herb, on some level, was really working on both levels. His work was marvelously entertaining. But there are very few people in theater who even understand, even, what the hell is that? The security of the theater for the security of the world? What does that mean? You know? And I think Herb really knew what that meant. And I'm sorry I never got to see the Lincoln Center productions, because I think he was very hurt by what happened to him in New York. And yes. Yeah. But what I think of now is, as I think of Danton's Death, which I teach, and The Condemned of Altoona, which I haven't taught, these are two absolutely impossible plays to stage. I mean, you can do them, but you're going to run into trouble no matter what happens, because it takes hours to just penetrate them on the page. And what it also takes is an audience that is capable of listening to the merging of idea with, in Altoona's case, melodrama, and in Danton's case, I don't even know how to describe it. It's rhetoric. Yeah. It's almost oratorio as they're singing.
So you're saying that perhaps he already knew that, or chose those plays, perhaps even intentionally?
Well, it's like a Sisyphean thing. You're pushing that stone up, and the idea is, yeah, great, let's have some of this. Let's inject it into the system.
Center, yeah.
But, you know, New York just, whoo, bang, you know? Yeah. They just shut the door on that. Now, it's been done all over the place, I think, in other ways. Not those plays, but other things.
Yeah.
I think we do have a lot of good stuff going on here, but you have to search hard and far to see it. Okay, I just wanted to put that
for the conclusion of the evening, we're going to have an audio clip where I think Peter Bonney made a thing.
I think we can take
two questions.
Yeah,
or a comment, Ali, two questions or another comment.
Just wanting to add a postscript to Marvin's raising the question of Herb's personal generosity, which meant so much to me. In, I guess it was 95, 96, I had a fellowship that came really from Kathy Woodward to the Center for 20th Century Studies. So I spent the year in Milwaukee, and Herb went out of his way to, in addition to whatever I've taken from his work, my mind is filled with kind of sunlit afternoons over coffee when he was willing to take time and what are you working on. And that started an occasional correspondence that lasted until maybe a couple of months before he died, at a point at which he could no longer write. And even then, he was reaching out, always wanted to read what you had written. You know, he was one of the most extraordinarily generous and in personal relations, not egotistic people that I've dealt with in this field. Mm-hmm. I'm just adding that.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Is there one more question, or one or two, towards the panel or someone in the room? We're going to have a small reception here afterwards where we hope to say, but maybe we have a clip and Allison prepared it. And maybe we take the second one for the end. And Brett, can you play it? Or
This is the one from PAJ?
From PAJ, yeah.
Years ago, kept asking the theater, they just asked over and over again, what is the theater? And then I commented on that. Remember, I talked about it being impossible theater. I said I meant the word impossible in every conceivable sense, as both of the sense of, you know, to do the real theater, as Artaud, you know, spoke of the essential theater, or Gordon Craig from the real theater, all the great visionaries of that theater is impossible, the symbolist. That theater is impossible. But I also meant it as when you say that theater is impossible, when you say the word, we get teeth cries. It's impossible. You know, like the people are contemptible. The organism is awful. You can't raise money for it. The audience stinks. The city won't support it. Everything that surrounds it.
We love it. But, when we were in Berlin, we met Heinrich for the first time. He would introduce us as you know, you say, you know, to friends, these are my publishers. They hate the theater.
I do.
You got a big kick out of that.
But, let me ask you though. I mean, about the nature of artifice, because what you're saying obviously appertains not just to theater but to all art. I mean, in some sense that all art seems to, in various practices of art, whether it's fiction, poetry, painting, film, that it is involved in both a transcendental quest, I mean, in some sense, a quest for this ontological quest for purity, and at the same time, it is negated by that very quest, by that very procedure that it has to employ to approximate its goals. If that's the case, then what is art? And why do we need it? I mean, if you're not willing to accept the artifice of art, if you're not willing to accept its liabilities, then why are we drawn to art for sustenance or for spiritual growth, if that is what it is?
I know, over the years, I've had many, many responses, if not answers, to that question.
I mean, you obviously know. Finally, Wittgenstein just gave up all these, having to think about all these issues and the way the quest for ontological purity gets totally discredited through.
First, we downloaded it, but it gave you an idea, I think, of his speaking. Maybe we should have chosen a clip from the afternoon. But as the closing poem, and you reminded me, Bill Irving wanted to be here tonight, couldn't be. He has been in this company. Maybe, Dick, you read his note to us, which he wrote just for tonight.
Among all the theater study and practice...
One second, I'm going to give you this mic. It might work better. Yeah.
Among all the theater study and practice one racks up in a life, what made working with Herb Blau so central, so formative? It's not an easy question. Herb claimed that intellect was visceral, that thought could be action on a stage. I hadn't a clue what he meant, but there was something in his way of saying it that caught me and held me. Once when we were working on a passage from Aeschylus that speaks of the gods, and did we have any business, college kids, approaching that text? Herb said, "The question for humans has always been, why are we not gods?" And he put the question smoothly, like an anthropologist. But then he grabbed the blue sweatshirt he wore in our sessions. It was always a little too clean and pressed and a little too large for him. And he said, I ask, why the fuck am I not a god? And he asked it with that sudden Blauian ferocity which risked being comic in its size and intensity. Some people did laugh. A small, balding man clutching his clothing, reddening in the face. I may have laughed, I'm not sure, but I know I nodded in recognition. It was the most potent image of strength and weakness in the same moment. It was both skillful and guileless. It was a Greek play. Herb was not a scholar citing a question at that moment. He was a man asking the question. And I will never forget it, the skill, the guilelessness, the lament, the anger at nature. It was the seed of what builds towards the confidence you sometimes get as an actor to take on a Greek play, to take on a text that is much greater than you, to take on something beyond a normal scale, and to know that your best hope is to be a tiny but ferocious human within it. Herb also sometimes quoted Melville's description of Ahab as an ungodly, godlike man. It doesn't in any way describe Herb. He was too sweet and kind a man to like it to Ahab. But I've always thought that there was a part of him that would like that phrase somehow to figure in a remembrance. I've always had the hunch, and so I mention it. He also asked, "What prevents you?" And there is no better craft question in the theater. But the phrase I most remember in thinking of Herb, that those of us who worked with him at Oberlin thought might be a title for a biography someday, was one which Milt, the Warner Gymnasium custodian, spoke one night after he saw Herb alone in the gym doing Tai Chi. Milt's supervisor asked him at the foot of the stairs whether anyone was still in the building. Milt said, "Yes, there's one man, dancing."
So thank you for coming, and thank you to our panel. Thank you for taking time.